uniqueness. Of the expansion of a vector in a given base. Uniqueness of the expansion of a vector in a given basis. Expansion of a vector in a basis is a geometric procedure. It requires some drawing. It requires drawing some lines, measuring some projections, etc. So it's a rather complicated procedure, including geometry. Therefore, one can expect that using slightly different ways, slightly different geometric procedures could gain different expansions of a basis in a given, of a vector in a given basis. Our goal to show that despite to the various ways for expanding a vector in a basis, all expansions do coincide. So there is a unique expansion of a given vector in a given basis. Assume that some vector, for example, the vector A, is expanded in a basis with coefficients alpha, beta, and gamma. And assume that there is another expansion of the same vector in the same basis. We write it as follows: A equals alpha tilde E1 plus beta tilde E2 plus gamma tilde E3. So we assume that we have two expansions. Our goal is to show that these two expansions must coincide. Let's subtract this expansion from this expansion. A minus A, we get zero vector. Which is equal, when I subtract this term from this term, because we have a common factor E1, we can write alpha minus alpha tilde times E1. Similarly, the vector E2 is a common factor for these two terms. Therefore, here we have beta minus tilde beta E2. Plus, and in the last term we have gamma minus tilde gamma times E3. And all this expression is equal to zero, because here I have zero. Zero vector, this is a vector, this is also a vector, and E1 is also a vector. So we have the sum with coefficients. Any sum with coefficients is a linear combination. And we have linear combination is equal to zero. What we know about the vectors of basis? E1, E2, E3 are not coplanar. These vectors are not coplanar. Therefore, these vectors are linearly independent. Li, linearly independent. What does it mean, linearly independent? It means that if some linear combination of them is equal to zero, this linear combination must be trivial. For a linearly independent system of vectors, if some linear combination is equal to zero, then this linear combination must be trivial. Must be trivial. What does it mean, a trivial linear combination? A trivial linear combination is a linear combination with zero coefficients. The coefficients must be zero, since it is trivial. Where are the coefficients in this formula? The coefficient is alpha minus tilde alpha, the coefficient is beta minus tilde beta, and the coefficient is gamma minus tilde gamma. All of these coefficients must be zero. Therefore, we write alpha minus tilde alpha equal to zero, beta minus tilde beta equal to zero, and gamma minus tilde gamma is equal to zero. These equalities implies that alpha is equal to tilde alpha, beta is equal to tilde beta, and gamma is equal to tilde gamma. So, despite our assumption, the coefficients of the first expansion coincide with the coefficients of the second expansion. So these two expansions are not different. They do coincide. Thus we have proved the fact that each vector has a unique expansion in each given basis. Each vector has a unique expansion in each given basis. So if a vector A is given, its coefficients alpha, beta, and gamma are unique. And we can establish a correspondence. Each vector has a correspondence sequence of coefficients in its expansion in a given basis. This correspondence is two-lateral, so the vector corresponds to a sequence of coefficients, and conversely, any sequence of coefficients is associated with some vector. The association is performed through the formula of expansion. A equals alpha times E1 plus beta times E2 plus gamma times E3. So we can say that each vector is enumerated with its coefficients, is numerized. So a basis is a tool for numerization of a vector. a basis is a tool for numerization of a vector. And upon numerization, we can work with this vector like an array of numbers. In our particular case, with a triple of numbers. This correspondence, as I said, is bilateral. A corresponds to coefficients alpha, beta, and gamma, and conversely, the coefficients is associated or has a correspondent vector. The tool for establishing such a correspondence is a basis. Therefore, I write E1, E2, E3 over this bilateral arrow. A vector is denoted through the letter A, and its coefficients here are denoted through alpha, beta, and gamma. However, it's not very convenient to spend such many letters to denoting the coefficients of a single vector. We can use the letter A with the numbers 1, 2, 3 as indices. So instead of alpha, beta, and gamma, I can write alpha equals to A1, beta equals to A2, and gamma equals to A3. As a result, I have the correspondence of a vector A with three numbers A1, A2, A3. These numbers are called coordinates. Coordinates of a vector A. In this form, coordinates are enumerated with a number which is written below the letter A, to the right and below the letter A. However, there is a famous scientist whose name is Albert Einstein, who suggested to use upper indices, so the numbers which are set not below but above the letter A. Upper indices. What are upper indices? If I take some letter A and put some number above the letter A to the right of it, so this is an upper index. If I set the same number to the right but below the letter A, then this index is called lower index. So the upper index looks like a power, like an exponential. However, it is not an exponent. The upper index is an upper index. It's not an exponent. Using upper indices, we can write the expansion of a vector A in the following form. A equals A1 times E1 plus A2 times E2 plus A3 times E3. So 1, 2, 3 are not exponents. They are upper indices. upper indices are not exponents. Using upper indices make many formulas in geometry more clear, more readable. And therefore, using upper indices is a beneficial action. In particular, this formula can be written in as follows. A equals the summation sign with some letter I running from 1 to 3. And here I write A sub I times E sub I. So this is an Einstein form of writing an expansion of a vector in a basis. In this formula, one index I, which is a summation index, is a lower index, and the other index I, which is a summation index, is an upper index. So upper and lower index are grouped with each other. They are joined, they are subdivided into groups. And each time in a formula containing some summation with a with upper indices should include one upper index and one lower index exactly. In this case, such a formula is called a true, a valid tensorial formula. Valid tensorial formula. Later on, we always use upper indices. We shall always use upper indices in order to get used to them, to make them habitual for us. Our next topic is the change of basis. Change of a basis. Why we need to change a basis? Because bases are not equivalent to each other. Some of them can be useful in one cases, and others can be more useful in other cases. And if we need to consider both cases, we sometimes need to transfer, to pass from one basis to another basis. So we need to change our basis for the sake of it's convenient in an appropriate case. So now we shall consider change of basis. In order to change a basis, we need to have not one basis, but two bases. Assume that we have the first basis, which is denoted E1, E2, E3, and the second basis, which is denoted E1 tilde, E2 tilde, E3 tilde. And suppose that we need to change the first basis for the second one. The formulas for changing bases need some numeric coefficients for recalculating one basis with respect to another. Let's take the first vector of the second basis. We shall call the first basis an old basis, and we shall call the second basis a new basis. Let's take the first vector of the second basis, E sub 1 tilde. Regarding to the first basis, the vector E sub 1 is a regular vector, is not peculiar, it is not special. And therefore, as a regular vector, it can be expanded with respect to the first basis. Let's write its expansion. And in order to write this expansion, we need some notation for the coefficient. It is used to note the expansion of one basis with respect to another basis using the letter S. S1 E1 plus S2 E2 plus S3 E3. This is a formula of expansion. Note that the numbers 1, 2, and 3 are not powers, are not exponentials. They are just indices. They are just numbers used for enumerate these coefficients. So we have managed to expand the first vector, and let's proceed to the second vector, E2. Again, I shall use the same letter S for denoting coefficients. So S1 E1, S2 E2 plus S3 E3. Looking at these two formulas, you can ask why these vectors are different, but the expansions are not different. And you are right, these two expansions should be different. And we must indicate the way of in which these two formulas are different. Here we have the number 1 saying that we expand the first vector. And here we have number 2, which says that we expand the second vector. Let's transfer this number to S. So here we write not S1, but S1 and 1 again. S2 and 1, S3 and 1. The number 1 below the letter S shows that we expand the vector with the number 1 of the second basis. Similarly, we shall bring this letter 2 below the letter S in order to show that we have the expansion of the second vector. So it's also an expansion. And finally, let's write the third expansion for the third vector. Tilde E sub 3 is equals S1 3 E1 plus S1 2 3 E2 plus S3 3 E3. So we have written three expansions. Each expansion comprises three coefficients, and we have three expansions. As a result, we have nine coefficients. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Nine coefficients. They are enumerated with two indices, upper index and lower index, upper index and lower index, upper index and lower index. So each term is enumerated with two indices, and therefore we can arrange these coefficients into a matrix. We shall construct a matrix using these coefficients. This coefficient is the first coordinate of the vector E1 tilde. This coefficient is the second coordinate of the vector E1 tilde. And this coefficient is the third coordinate of the vector E1 tilde. Therefore, we shall write this coefficients, these coordinates, as a column, one above another. So S11, S12, S13. Then in the second column, I shall write these three coefficients: S21, S22, S23. And in the third column, I shall write the coefficients from the third formula: S31, S32, S33. As a result, I get a matrix S. This matrix has its name. It is called a transition matrix. Transition matrix. So, if we have two bases, and if we expand the vectors of the second basis with respect to the first basis, we get a transition matrix. Here we have called this basis as an old basis, and this basis as a new basis. And when we pass from something old to something new, we move in a direct direction. So this transition performed with the matrix S is called a direct transition, and this matrix therefore is called a direct transition matrix. And above this arrow I shall write the name of the matrix S. Further, we can exchange, we can swap these bases. We can consider this basis as an old and this basis as a new, in order to perform an inverse and a backward transition. So let this one be E1 tilde, E2 tilde, E3 tilde, and we perform a transition in this direction to E1, E2, E3. This direction is inverse to this one. And like in this case, I can write the formulas which are similar to this one. Its coefficients, though, are denoted not through S, but they are denoted through the letter T. E1 is equal to T1 1 E1 tilde plus T1 2 E2 tilde plus T1 3 E3 tilde. This formula is very similar to this formula. The difference is that tilde now on the right hand side of this formula, and the vector E without tilde is in the left hand side of this formula. Let's proceed to this one and to this one. Both of them have analogs. E2 without tilde is equal to T21 E1 tilde plus T22 E2 tilde plus T23 E3 tilde. And for the third vector E3 is equal T 3 1 E 1 tilde plus T 3 2 E 2 tilde plus T 3 3 E 3 tilde. Like in the first case, in this case we can compose a matrix. It is denoted through T. And we shall write these coefficients from the first formula in the first column. So we shall have T11, T12, T13. Then T21, T22, T23, and finally T31, T32, T33. This matrix is also called a transition matrix. Transition matrix. However, since this direction is inverse to the previous one, we shall call this matrix an inverse transition matrix. So the matrix S is a direct transition matrix, and here this is an inverse transition matrix. The same names are applied to the transition formulas, to formulas. So we have two formulas. This set of formulas and this set of formulas. These formulas are called direct or direct transition formulas, and these formulas are called inverse transition formulas. Direct transition formulas and inverse transition formulas. Both two formulas can be written in a short form. And now, looking at this arrow, I can draw another arrow in the inverse direction, and below this arrow I can put the inverse transition matrix. This diagram simply shows that when we pass from an old basis to a new basis, this transition is called direct transition, and its matrix is denoted through S, and it is called a direct transition matrix. And if we pass from a new basis to an old basis, this direction is called an inverse direction. Therefore, the corresponding matrix is called the inverse transition matrix. Let's write short forms of transition formulas. The direct transition formula: E tilde with the number I is equal to the sum, where the number j runs from 1 to 3, and where coefficients are the components of the direct transition matrix, with the indices I below and with the index j above, in the upper position, is multiplied by the vector I with the index j and without tilde. And similarly, in the inverse direction, E with the index I is equal to the sum where j runs from 1 to 3, t j I multiplied by the vector E tilde with number j. So this is a direct transition formula, and this is the inverse transition formula. Direct and inverse transition formulas. Why do we need these two transition matrices? Because they connect numerically two bases, and they facilitate the procedure of finding components of or coordinates of a given vectors in both of these two bases. Our next topic is transformation. Of coordinates of a vector when changing a basis. Transformation of coordinates of a vector when changing a basis. Assume that we have some vector. Let's denote it through X. And assume that we have two bases, E1, E2, E3, and the second basis E1 tilde, E2 tilde, E3 tilde. Since both of them are bases, we can expand this vector x with respect to this basis, and we can expand this vector x with respect to the second basis. So we have two expansions, and let's write them as follows. X is equal to the sum of its coordinates x with the number I multiplied by the vector e with the number I. The letter I runs from 1 to 3. And similarly, x is equal to the sum with respect to the index I running from 1 to 3. X with tilde and with the index I is multiplied by the vector tilde I. So this one and this one are two expansions of the same vector. The coefficients of these two expansions are uniquely determined by this vector x. Therefore, once we know the coefficients xy here, we equally know the coefficients of the vector the coefficients xy with tilde. Because they are in one-to-one correspondence, they are related by a very hard relationship, very hard correspondence. So each one corresponds exactly to one different set of coordinates. We can say that we should have formulas binding tilde x's here with x's here. And our goal is to derive a formula expressing tilde x through x's. Here we have the sum where vectors are denoted through e sub I, where I runs from 1 to 3. But for vectors e sub y, we have the formula here, which is called the inverse transition formula. It expresses e sub y, e sub I, through tilde e sub j. And let's substitute this expression to this expression, to here. Well, then for the vector x, we can write x is equal to the sum I from 1 to 3 x I e I, which is equal to the sum where I runs from 1 to 3, x I, and here instead of e I shall write the sum where the inverse matrix T is used, T I j is multiplied by e tilde j. Where j runs from 1 to 3. Now we shall open the brackets. We shall expand this expression. In expanding, instead of one sum and the second sum inside the first one, we shall have a double sum. I runs from 1 to 3 and j runs from 1 to 3. And near this sum, I shall write xy, tyj and ej with tilde. So X I T I J and E J with tilde. Here we should perform double summation. We shall compute the double sum. However, we know that when performing a summation, the order of summand does not matter. So we can consider the summation with respect to J as an outer summation and the summation with respect to I as an inner summation. And as a result, we get the double summation. Now let's exchange the order of these summations. Let's write the summation with respect to the letter J in the first place and the summation with respect to the letter I as a second summation. So I shall write the sum with respect to the letter J from 1 to 3 and then the summation with respect to the letter I from 1 to 3 X I T I J A J with tilde. When performing the second summation, the index I changes while the index J does not change. Therefore, the coefficient E sub J is a common coefficient for all terms where the summation with respect to I is performed. This common factor can be written outside the brackets, so it can be brought outside the brackets, and we can write this sum as follows. The sum with respect to J, where J runs from 1 to 3, then we set some big round bracket, and inside this bracket I shall write the inner sum. I runs from 1 to 3, and here I have this term and this term, but not this term, because this is a common factor which is written outside the brackets. And here I shall write these two terms. T I J and the term X I. I have swapped these terms because this is a regular multiplication, the multiplication of numbers. We know that the multiplication of numbers is commutative. Therefore, I can swap them within this formula. So, what I see? I see that here the vector x is expressed as a sum of the basis vectors e tilde with coefficients which are given by these brackets. And here I have the expansion of the vector x with respect to the vectors e sub tilde common, and looking at these two formulas, here letter I. However, I can use in this formula the letter J, and I can write this formula in the following way. The letter J runs from 1 to 3, X with tilde with the number J is multiplied by E with the index j and with tilde. In this form, these two formulas are very similar. This formula is an expansion in the basis e tilde, and this formula is also an expansion in the basis e tilde. Two different expansions of the same vector in the same basis cannot exist. We have proved in the beginning the fact of uniqueness of an expansion of a vector in a given basis. Therefore, these two formulas should share the coefficients. They should have the same coefficients. X j tilde should be equal to tilde x So let's write the concluding formula. Xj with tilde from this formula is equal to the value of this square of this round brackets. So it is equal to the sum with respect to the index I running from 1 to 3. And here we have t with lower index I and upper index j multiplied by xi. This formula is called direct transformation formula. Direct transformation formula. Let's compare it with these two formulas. This formula is called direct transition formula, and this formula is called direct transformation formula. The titles are different, the names are different, and the meanings also are different. The transition formulas expresses vectors of one basis through the vectors of another basis. Transformation formulas are used to express coordinates of a given vector from one basis to another basis. So let's write the inverse transformation formula. The method of writing it is not tricky. We shall not rederive this formula. We shall simply rewrite it. Because our direction is inverse, we need to write x's without tilde in the left side. So we write x with j, with upper index j, is equal to the sum where I runs from 1 to 3. And because the direction is different, instead of this formula t, of this coefficient t, we shall use the coefficient denoted through s. S. Oh, well, I see. The paper is below the screen observation field. Yes. S with the index I below and with the index J above, and is multiplied by X with the index I above. And this X is with tilde. So this formula is called the inverse transformation. Inverse transformation formula. Let's make some observation. This formula is direct transition formula. So the direction is direct and induce the direct transition matrix. This formula is a direct is the inverse transition formula, and it uses the inverse transition matrix. So the type of transition matrix in these two formulas coincides with the type of a transition matrix. And the same is not this is not valid for these two formulas. Look, this formula is called direct formula. However, it uses the inverse matrix. This formula is called inverse formula. However, it uses the direct transition matrix. So here the use of matrices is converse to the name of the formulas. Direct formula uses the inverse matrix, and the inverse formula uses the direct matrix. This is a peculiarity of the transformation formulas. The transformation formulas are dual to the transition formulas. These two formulas are dual to these two formulas. And because of the duality, some features are different in these formulas compared to these two formulas. So that's almost all which concerns the transition and transformation of bases, so the change of bases. My last remark is that the inverse transition matrix T is an inverse matrix with respect to the direct transition matrix. So T is equals S to the minus first power. And similarly, S is equal to T to the minus first power. And if we multiply T by S or S by T, because they are inverse to each other, we shall get the unit matrix. T times S is equal to E, and this E is equal to S times T. T times S and S times E both are equal to the unit matrix, to the identity matrix, which is denoted through E. Now we have completed the topic concerning the change of bases. Let's consider some examples. Physics, or in many applied fields of science, orthogonal bases are used. For example, if I have this paper, I have small squares on it, and I can write the coordinate system. And then, for example, I can mark some scaling, some scales, and write 1, 2, and so on, 1, 2, and so on. And then I can mark two vectors connecting the origin O with the point marked with 1 on the horizontal axis and with the point 1 on the vertical axis. We can call this vector as E1 and we can call this vector as E2. And now let's rotate these two vectors about this point. So perform something like this, the rotation. What shall I have upon rotation? This vector turns to some angle, and this vector also turns to some vector, to some angle. The angle alpha, and here the rotation angle is also alpha. And these two vectors, we shall call them E sub 1 tilde and E sub 2 tilde. Can we write the transition formulas for these pairs of vectors? Certainly, yes. We can write the transition formulas. For this purpose, I should expand the vector E1 tilde with respect to the vectors E1 and E2. Let's redraw the picture, the image. So this is a vector E1 tilde. It has it makes the angle alpha with the axis with the horizontal axis. And in order to find its coordinates, I draw the projection and the projection upon another axis. So the length of these projections, assume that the length of this vector is 1. So E1, its length is equal to 1. Then the length of projection to the horizontal axis is cosine of this alpha. Cosine of alpha, and the vertical projection is the sine of alpha. Therefore, we can write that E1 tilde is equal to cosine alpha times E1 plus sine alpha times E2. Now let's consider the second vector, E2 tilde. For its projections, this angle is alpha. This projection is cosine alpha, and this projection is sine alpha. However, this projection is directed not to the right, but to the left, while the axis itself is directed to the right. Therefore, this sine is taken with opposite sign. So we shall write E2 tilde is equal minus sine alpha times E1 plus cosine alpha times E2. Looking at these two formulas, we see that they are transition formulas. Taking transition formulas and taking their coefficients, we can write the transition matrix. The transition matrix, which is named S, is obtained from the direct transition formulas. Its coulombs are formed by this coefficient. So cosine and sine form the first coulomb. Cosine alpha, sine alpha. Then the coefficients of the second formula form the second coulomb in this matrix. So here the first coefficient is minus sine, and the second coefficient is cosine. So we have get the transition matrix. Cosine, cosine along the primary diagonal, and sine and minus sine are along the secondary diagonal. Such a matrix containing cosines and sines is called the rotation matrix. It corresponds to the rotation, the rotations by the vector, by the angle alpha in the counterclockwise direction. Counterclockwise. So the rotation in this direction is a counterclockwise direction. And if we rotate in this direction, then instead of alpha, we should take minus alpha in this formula. And that would be an inverse rotation matrix, or the rotation matrix in the clockwise direction.